All right, and we're live. Welcome, everybody. Thank you all so much for tuning in. Episode number 51. We've been going strong for over 4 years now. I really appreciate all the support I get every month for Toby's Tech Talk. I hope you guys are getting a lot of good tips out of it. Question came in here from Mark. He says, why am I not at SOLIDWORKS World? That's a great question, Mark. I am not at SOLIDWORKS World because of a number of reasons, but ultimately it's because I couldn't stand leaving you guys here. I wouldn't want to leave you guys here on the East Coast and go out to Texas. So I said, wait, when is SOLIDWORKS World? Oh, no. I have Toby's Tech Talk that week. I cannot leave. So that's why I'm here with you guys today. But it is true. It's a great point that Mark makes. SOLIDWORKS World is happening this week. There's been a lot of cool announcements. I'm going to show you guys some of those announcements. It was broadcast live, so there was a live stream. Now, I've been doing tech support all week, so I've been able to kind of tune into it a little bit, but I haven't been able to catch every single little thing they're saying. What's cool is that they also have it posted on demand. So they have like a recording of the live, and then you can actually watch that. So check that out if you want to see what happened at SOLIDWORKS World this week. Day three is probably the most sought after day. So I hope that they will broadcast what they did today, or I hope that they will post it. They did day one and two, and they posted those. What's nice about day three is that they show you Model Mania. They show you who won Model Mania. They show you what is going to be new in SOLIDWORKS 2017. Along with all of the top enhancement requests for 2017. So some pretty cool things they go through and actually show you some of the new features. One of the new features they showed in 2017 that I thought looked pretty cool was you can do a variable chamfer, kind of like a variable radius, and you can also take any chamfer and change it to a fillet and back without deleting the feature. You can just do an edit feature command and change a chamfer to a fillet. So if you start out with the design with a chamfer and then you go to the customer and they say, you know, I want that to be a little more rounded, now you can actually go back and change it from a chamfer to a fillet, which I think is pretty cool. But there was a lot more beyond that. That was just something that when I saw that, I was like, wow, I like that. They also, maybe they were watching my Toby's Tech Talk last week or last month, I don't know, but they also, in the thread creation tool that was added in 2016, they added a utility to allow for a lead in and a lead out right within that thread creation utility. So I hope you guys still got a lot out of that, but it looks like in 2017, you're going to be able just to make those with the lead in, lead out right within the tool. So, all right. So with that intro, again, I just want to say thank you all so much for tuning in. My name is Toby Schnaars, and welcome to Toby's Tech Talk. As always, we have an introduction, the tech alert, the Prism and SOLIDWORKS news, the monthly modeling contest, which is going to be on hold this month. And the reason I put it on hold this month is because I didn't post the video from last month until last week. That video is posted now on our YouTube page, so check that out, and that'll give you guys a little more time. If you do have questions on it, you know, you can fire in those questions. I've definitely helped some of my my followers on Toby's Tech Talk before, so feel free to fire those questions in if you do have any questions on it. Okay, as always, camera is up here. I have a second screen over here, so if you see me look that way, that means I'm looking at my second screen, and I have the camera mounted on the second screen today, so if I'm always looking over here to the left, it's not because I'm lying, right? Instant 2D, Instant 3D. I'm going to talk to you guys a little bit about that as a quick tip today. And then we'll get into our final tip here on the free Xpress products. First of all, I want to make sure everyone can hear me. I like to launch these polls during Toby's Tech Talk. So let me just launch this poll now. Can you hear me? Launch. All right. So just a simple yes or no with the third option. You sound like you're in a cave. Okay, so hopefully I don't sound like I'm going to cave to anybody, but if I do, maybe you have the reverb dialed up on your mixer, and that's why I sound that way. All right, good. 90% of the attendees voted, and everyone said they can hear me, so that's awesome. Everybody's able to hear me this month. That's wonderful. All right, let's move on here. Quick tip, Instant 2D and Instant 3D. Instant 3D has been in the software for a long time. Instant 2D was added in SOLIDWORKS 2016. Okay, the reason that these matter, the reason you should know about these is because they are on out of the box. So when you install the software, when you do a new install, if you clear your registry, you're going to have Instant 3D and Instant 2D on. So it's important you know what they are. Okay, so let's talk about Instant 3D first, and then we'll talk about Instant 2D. Now, I recently did clear my registry, so my settings are all kind of out of whack right now. So I'm going to just change some of the settings that I always change whenever I start a new session of SOLIDWORKS. And those would be in the sketch section of system options. I say enable on-screen numeric input on entity creation. And I say create dimension only when a value is entered. I always do that because then when I press the S key and I go to my center rectangle, I can click here, move my mouse, let go of my mouse, and then type on the 10 key 3x6. And now I've got a nice fully defined rectangle right there on the origin. In this case, though, actually what I'm going to do is I'm going to mix it up a little bit, and I'm going to put this here at the origin, just because I want to illustrate instant 2D, instant 3D. Now I'm going to right mouse button on my S key menu, I'm going to choose customize, and I'm going to add my features to the S key menu. With 2016 and the colors being the way that they are, I've been adopting an approach where I just add all my features to the lowest line of the toolbar. So what I mean by that is that if I'm going to use extrude and I'm going to use cut extrude and maybe I'm going to use some other features, I just always add them down here at the very bottom. And that seems to at least give me a little bit of help as far as where to go for those features. But if anybody was watching the live stream today, you'll be happy to hear that they made a little announcement about these colors. So in SOLIDWORKS 2016, we might be able to get our old colors back without needing to do any weird, you know, modification to the DLLs and icon extraction, all that fun stuff. I've been killing myself trying to find those icons, and I've been coming up empty. But SOLIDWORKS 2016, they're going to supposedly give us the option to go back to our classic colors, they call it. I'll show you guys a slide about that in just a little bit. Here I'm going to go to Features. I'm going to go to S key Extrude. Now that I've added that Extrude command, I'm going to bring this up. The value for the Extrude is already highlighted, so I'll just type in 1 inch, enter, enter. I click on this face, and whoa, look at all those dimensions that came up, right? Look at all these dimensions that showed up here. Jeez Louise, that's a lot of dimensions showing up there. And if I grab this little arrow here and I drag this arrow up and down, I can resize this model. This is a function of Instant 3D, okay? The two things that you see when you work with Instant 3D is you see that all the dimensions in your sketch will show up whenever you select a feature, a face of that sketch. So for example, if I create this underdefined sketch, right mouse button in the background and say fully defined sketch, so SOLIDWORKS goes through and it adds all my dimensions, and then I do S key extrude and I right mouse button and I say through all, and then I right mouse button again. And now if I was to select the face of that hole, with Instant 3D turned on, okay, you're going to make a liar out of me. With Instant 3D turned on, all of the dimensions for that feature show up. So that's kind of the behavior that you will see when you've got Instant 3D turned on. If you click and you drag the tip of one of these dimensions, you can resize the feature. If you single click on a dimension, its value will show up and you can change that value and the geometry will immediately update, or it will update instantly in 3D, hence the name. And same thing here, if I click on one of these features, if I click on this sketch, for example, and then I click on this dimension here, I can change it. So when SOLIDWORKS 2016 came out, somebody said, hey, that's kind of cool functionality. Wouldn't it be nice if we just had that in regular sketch mode? And this is why when you go into regular sketch mode and you single click on a dimension, you're getting this now. What is this? Where's my modify box? How come I can't just move the dimension? Right? Sometimes even if you double click, you just get this. Right? And you're wondering, how come I can't just change my dimensions? So I change this to 7.5, enter. Or if I click on that dimension and then I click on this endpoint here, I can grab that endpoint and drag it around. This is a function of what's called Instant 2D. So this is in the software, out of the box. Instant 3D is turned on, out of the box. Instant 2D is turned on, out of the box. And when you single click on a face and all these dimensions show up, or if you single click on a dimension and you get its value, that's because Instant 3D is turned on. If I turn that off, it goes back to more of the classic style of SOLIDWORKS. I'm going to just start doing that every time I say something that used to work the way that I really liked it. I'm going to say the classic way. So the classic style of SOLIDWORKS is that we would do Instant 3D, or Instant 3D would be turned off. We double click on a face to get the dimensions to show up. We double click on the dimension, and then we get this nice option to change it per configuration, things like that. And same thing with these holes here. I double click on this face and I get dimensions to show up. Okay, and we double click on a dimension to change it. So in SOLIDWORKS 2016, what we found is that we single click on a dimension and its value just shows up here. That's a function of Instant 2D. The same kind of capability of dragging and dropping your geometry, or dragging and dropping the endpoint of your extension lines or dimension lines, is a function of what's called Instant 2D. So we can turn off Instant 2D by going to the sketch toolbar and clicking here. And that's kind of what I'm showing in this slide here. You've got your Instant 3D and your Instant 2D. When you're working with Instant 3D, that's going to be on the Features toolbar at the end of that toolbar. With Instant 2D, that's on the Sketch toolbar at the end of the toolbar. And when Instant 2D is on, You might have noticed that you click on your dimension and the value is just editable. When it's off, it works the way it always worked. It works the classic way. And then if we double click, we get this box to show up, and there we go. All right, so let me see here. Let me just do, let me just make a quick poll here. I'm just curious how many people were being affected by that. So let me just, this is just going to take me a second. I got to type in the new question. I'm just curious if you were being affected by this. Affected by Instant 2D in sketches. And I'll just say yes, no. I'll give you guys a third option there too. All right, I'm going to just launch this poll for you. I'm curious if you guys were affected by this instant. How many people were affected by this? Like, you were wondering. Yeah, you know, how come when I click on my dimension, it's just automatically changing? All right, cool. Good. All right, so about a quarter of you are saying yes, you were affected by this. Let's close that poll there. All right, cool. I appreciate it. Here, I'll show you guys the result there from that poll. So I do really appreciate you guys, you know, just taking a moment to fill that out. And it's good to know. It's good to know that it's hitting home a little bit and that hopefully you're not going to be affected by that anymore. You're not, you know, you're going to kind of know what's going on with that instant 3D, instant 2D kind of stuff. Well, I'm just looking for there it is. GoTo webinar gives you a little like a monitor kind of thing. So I can see how much of a lag I'm getting. Wait, this is audience view. That's not right. It's not even showing my screen. Oh, I guess after the poll, it stopped showing my screen. Oh, there we go. Okay. I'm such a professional at using this GoTo software, right? I've only been using it for 51 episodes. Still figured out how to navigate my way through it. All right. So here we go. So now we're going to continue with the presentation here and talk about a little bug that came up this month in tech support and why I wanted to show you guys about Instant 3D and Instant 2D. So, sorry, let me just mute this phone. So with Instant 3D, Instant 2D, so with, yeah, just unplug the phone for a second. So with Instant 3D, Instant 2D, what we're seeing here is that the bug that came up had to do with Hole Wizard. And it's a little thing, but it's one of these things that drives me crazy. So I'm really glad that it was reported. And I am thankful to our user who reported this issue. And this has to do with Hole Wizard. So here I am, I'm in sketch mode. And with sketch mode, I've got Instant 2D turned on. And again, this is out of the box. So that's going to, you know, affect my behavior when I'm working in sketch mode. And then I'm going to go into features and I'm going to go to Hole Wizard in my features. And I'm going to choose the type of hole that I want to create here. And then I'm going to go to my positions tab and I'm going to click here on this positions tab, drop in some points here. And then I'm going to create a smart dimension that goes from this line to this point. And I go and I drop that smart dimension and the dialog box kind of flashes for a second. And then I'm not in the focus of the modify spin box. So what I mean is that the value here didn't begin highlighted in blue. And like I said, this is just one of those little things that drives me personally crazy. And so when it was reported, I was like, oh yeah, I totally see what you're seeing. I'm getting the same thing here. So I went and looked it up and it's a bug. It's a known bug. It's a known SPR. And it says, you know, here's the issue. The issue is that you're losing the focus of the modify spin box when you are going to dimension. And the reason why is because Instant 2D is turned on. So if I turn off Instant 2D, and I go smart dimension, and I go from here to here. There we go. Now it's nice and highlighted. Love it. Type in the value, move on with my day. So that's something that you can be aware of with Instant 2D. That's kind of how it came up, and that's where I like to pull these kind of tech tips from is cases I get into with my customers throughout the month when I'm doing tech support. But that is what Instant 2D and Instant 3D are, and those are on out of the box in SOLIDWORKS 2016. So look out for them. Instant 3D has been there for a while, but Instant 2D, now maybe you know why your sketches are behaving a certain way. All right, again, my name is Toby Schnaars, here from Prism Engineering. I am a SOLIDWORKS user, SOLIDWORKS expert, SOLIDWORKS elite applications engineer, so a lot of different topics that I get to cover as I'm doing tech support training, things like that. Been doing a lot of training lately, which I love. So I'm glad to be out doing that on the road. SOLIDWORKS Tech Alert. This is something that I mentioned last month. I just want to mention it again. SOLIDWORKS PDM standard is now part of SOLIDWORKS Professional. So Workgroup PDM is being end-of-lifed in SOLIDWORKS, at the end of SOLIDWORKS 2017, the release next year. And when that occurs, you will be encouraged to move to SOLIDWORKS PDM standard. It's already available. We can help you get it up and running. There is one point of contact you have to make with the reseller. We have to help you get the seat. I forget what it's called. It's like, it's basically activated. Get the license activated. So when you're ready to install PDM standard, or if you're planning on doing it, just contact us before you get started, and we'll make sure that your serial number works and everything, and that it's available to be activated. But PDM standard is kind of like enterprise PDM, except that it is throttled back as far as capability goes, and it's available with every seat of SOLIDWORKS Professional. So, summary, I beat up that topic in more detail last month, so if you want to go back and watch the YouTube on last month, you can see some more info on that. SP5 was released. As always, we always like to remind you that when a service pack is released, you can go and you can look at the fixed SPRs on the service pack page. SP1 for 2016 was released. That's what I'm running on my screen. So as you see me working through SOLIDWORKS, you'll see that on my screen. There's a full download available of SOLIDWORKS. I always send out this email. I sent it out already today twice, reminding people how to get a copy of that full download. So you go to SOLIDWORKS.com and you can download that. And there's also a video on that, on how to do the full download. So if you don't like reading, but you want to hear my voice, you can check out our video on YouTube on how to do that full download. Just in case you don't get enough Toby from Toby's Tech Talk. There's some new YouTube videos, a full download of SOLIDWORKS. I mentioned a moment ago, SOLIDWORKS network license update. Clear the registry. Okay, this is a fun one. I even put a warning in the beginning of this one, but there's a clearing the registry video now available on YouTube. So in the clearing the registry video, we talk about, you know, why you would do this, you know, why you would want to do this. We talk about how to go through the process. We talk about how to be careful about what you're doing. We talk about using rename instead of using delete. But clearing the registry is basically something that you want to consider doing if SOLIDWORKS starts behaving abnormally. If you're going along and everything's good and then it starts crashing all of a sudden over and over and over again, and it was fine for a while, nothing else major changed, it could be something the registry got corrupted and you can go through and you can clear it. It's just kind of a good, quick, easy thing that you can do. It's easy to do. It's easy to follow those steps. As long as you only rename that one key, you're not really going to mess anything up. I even say in the video, if you rename that one single key and you don't touch anything else in the registry, probably the worst thing that could happen is that you might lose your settings, and that's it. So as long as you follow those instructions, you'll be fine. If you don't follow the instructions, if you go off on your own and you say, "Oh, I'm gonna start editing all these registry keys," then you're on your own. Then you could really screw up Windows. Okay, but as long as you kind of stick to that tutorial, it's just a really quick, easy way to say, "Is a problem with my registry?" You know, and the way you would do that is you would go in, you would rename the registry, you would launch SOLIDWORKS again and see if the problem goes away. And if it does, then the issue is almost certainly in your registry, although it could be in an add-in. I had a tech case this week where I helped somebody clear the registry. And what happened is when I think they were running Bobcam, and when I cleared the registry, the Bobcam add-in was turned off. And so then after that, it worked. The procedure worked. They were unable to save. And then they were able to save again. But then when the Bobcam add-in was turned back on, they stopped being able to save again. So clearing the registry actually wasn't the solution. The solution was turning off that add-in. But when we cleared the registry, everything goes back to out of the box, so the add-in was turned off. But that's kind of more of the exception rather than the rule. In general, if you clear your registry and the issue goes away, the problem is probably with your settings. You probably have a bad settings file in there, and you want to go through and you want to recreate your settings. Another thing I talk about in the video is how to use a cool program called MW Snap, which is a screen capture program that you can hotkey. So like you've got everybody has the Windows snipping tool, right? You go to the start snipping tool, and then you can capture something, capture a picture of this handsome devil here, right? My mouth open, and then you can take that image and you can save it. Well, what MW Snap does, there's two things that are advantageous over top of the snipping tool. First thing it does is that it gives you the ability to assign a hotkey to that. So I use Alt L. So whenever I want to do a screen capture, I do Alt L, and whatever area I capture before it captures again. And the other thing that it does is it automatically saves into one single directory. So you can check out that video on clearing the registry. It's on our Prism Engineering YouTube page. And it'll explain how to use that MW snap. But basically what it'll explain is that you could go to options. So I'm still doing that in 2016. You can go to options here and you can go on the first page and you could capture this and then click on the next page. And then you can do Alt L. The next page, Alt L, next page, Alt L, Alt L, Alt L, and go through this whole thing and it'll capture the same area over and over again, but it'll also put it into a folder for you and index it 001, 002, 003, 004. And then what's nice about that is now you've got a listing of all your settings. And then you can go through and you can recreate your settings fresh, not bringing in any corruption from any past setup. So if you're interested in that, if that sounds like something that might help you get SOLIDWORKS running a little bit better, you know, check it out. It's a good quick trick you can use. Prism recommendations for SOLIDWORKS, same as last month. 64-bit Windows 7, 16 gig of RAM, supported graphics card, solid state hard drive. Where do we find out more news about SOLIDWORKS? I know I've talked about this before, but I think this definitely bears repeating. You go to SOLIDWORKS.com. Once you get to SOLIDWORKS.com, up at the top, you click Login. Once you click Login, you go here to SOLIDWORKS Customer Portal. And then you log in, use your username and your password. And then over here on the right, you've got these popular solutions. Okay, SOLIDWORKS product news. And they might even talk about areas of the software that you don't normally get into. You've got your SOLIDWORKS. This is a bottleneck for flow simulation issue. You know, even if you're not in flow simulation, just as an engineer, it's interesting to see how these phenomenon can affect the software. And then there's some other things here. It says, which SOLIDWORKS products were moved to lower level packages with the release of SOLIDWORKS 2016? That's a good question. That's not something that I would have necessarily thought to ask. So it's kind of cool that it's here in this newsletter. Okay, SOLIDWORKS Utilities is now included in SOLIDWORKS Standard. FeatureWorks is now included in SOLIDWORKS Standard. So when you're in 2016, you know, any file that you open that's an imported document, you can unrecognize using FeatureWorks. Scan to 3D is now in Professional, and Tall Analyst was moved from Premium to Professional as well. I just was talking to somebody this morning about Tall Analyst. I couldn't remember if it was in Premium or Professional, and the customer said to me, you know what, Toby, I have Premium, so it doesn't matter. And I said, okay. But now I know. Now I'll know for the next person that I talk to. So SOLIDWORKS 2016, you know, news, tips, tricks. It's kind of like a monthly newsletter you can check out there from SOLIDWORKS. That's a good resource. Where else can we go for resources? We can go to my.solidworks.com. My.solidworks.com. Another awesome resource for everything SOLIDWORKS related. It's kind of like an aggregate of a number of different types of searches. So searches through forums, searches through knowledge base, searches for online tutorials, searches for actual CAD models, all included here in this one single search utility, SOLIDWORKS, My SOLIDWORKS. So really cool stuff here that you can take a look at as far as resources to find more news about SOLIDWORKS. Okay, let's take a look here. SOLIDWORKS World this week. It happened this week, right? So here's some announcements that I thought were really interesting. And there's certainly other announcements too. They're rebranding Mechanical Conceptual, calling it xDrive, giving you some available online solutions for CAD modeling. There's a lot of other cool things, but one of the things was they did announce that SOLIDWORKS Visualize is officially released as of this week. So SOLIDWORKS Visualize, I think it was Bunkspeed that was doing the engine for that. This is one of those spots where I probably should have just searched it first and then said what I think it is. But SOLIDWORKS Visualization, yep, here it is, formerly known as Bunkspeed. So very high quality renderings here. You can click gallery and you can see. So it's taking what you can do in PhotoView 360 and really upping the capabilities. This would be a perfect product if you were somebody who said, I've done renderings using PhotoView 360, but they aren't quite cutting it. Okay, so it's PhotoView 360 is included with SOLIDWORKS Professional, and if you decided that that wasn't quite cutting it, you know, this would be a higher end solution for rendering your SOLIDWORKS models. It's called SOLIDWORKS Visualization. So you can check it out on their the Google search, like what I did there. You can check it out on their website. You can get in touch with us. We can give you information on pricing for that purchased add-in. But SOLIDWORKS Visualization was announced this week. SOLIDWORKS PCB was announced this week. I actually didn't do any Google searches for it. I wonder if it's already posted as a product or if it's something they're still developing. SOLIDWORKS PCB, yeah, it doesn't look like it's officially posted yet. But The SOLIDWORKS PCB is another new add-in they announced this week that's going to complement the existing electrical capabilities of SOLIDWORKS, where you can actually do PC board design. SP3 of 2016 will offer full colors, and a shout out to my man Doug Kuhn, who won Model Mania on the user side. Awesome job, Doug. So you can see here, there was this slide that they posted that they said, in SOLIDWORKS 2016, SP3, there's going to be a new option, or they're planning for a new option for the classic icon colors to be visible. So in SOLIDWORKS 2016, hopefully in the next couple of months, we're going to see it, and we're going to be able to get our colors back, which I know that everybody is looking forward to, or almost everybody. I know that this is something that a lot of people have come up to me and talked to me about at users groups, have talked to me about at Toby's Tech Talk. So they have announced it officially, SP3 of SOLIDWORKS 2016. We should see that option for our classic icon colors, which is awesome. And Doug Kuhn from Kuhn Tool and Die, up in the Erie, Pennsylvania area, won Model Mania, first place. Awesome job, Doug. And That's two members, Chad is saying, that's two members of Toby's Tech Talk who have won Model Mania the past 2 years. That is a really good point that I didn't even think about. I just was thinking that I knew them both, but you're right. Two regular members of Toby's Tech Talk have won Model Mania the past 2 years. That is awesome. So congratulations, Doug. Congratulations, Tom Smith, for winning it last year. And we're really excited for everybody, but just a big congratulations there. You love it when you see your friends succeed and see them win contests like that. So awesome job, Doug. And if you're not familiar with Model Mania, check out the live cast. They did show the model. They also usually post all those Model Mania things on, there's a SOLIDWORKS forum on Model Mania where they have all of the past Model Mania models and the PDFs. So you could practice if you're going to go next year, you know, and this is something that gets you going, which for me, I love it. I love this kind of stuff. I love trying to look at a model and come up with a clever and a fast way of creating it. You actually have the ability to practice before you go out there, which is pretty cool. And it might give you that extra couple of seconds you need to take first place. As far as Prism Engineering news and events goes, we do have an events section at our website, www.prismeng.com. You can see there on that area of the website some of the different events, including our latest webinar series called Straight from Support, where Heather and Aaron talk about some of the most commonly dealt with SOLIDWORKS questions. So I've got about 50 people in the webinar right now. I'm curious how many of you have talked to Aaron or Heather. So let me just make a quick poll here. And I'm just curious, talk to Heather or Aaron. I wonder how many people have. So yes or no. This is just going to be a simple one. And I'm willing to bet that this is going to be up in the 90%. So let's see here. Have you talked to Aaron or Heather? Take a moment, if you don't mind, fill out that survey. I'm going to take a quick drink here. Wow, I am being proven wrong. There's a lot of people who haven't yet talked to Heather or Aaron. All right, well, you guys are going to be in for a treat when you call in. Let me just show the results here, because these guys are awesome. They are Heather is a Penn State graduate. Aaron is an MIT graduate. So we've got the brain trust here in SOLIDWORKS support at Prism Engineering under the leadership of Mr. Dan Wagner. So you guys are in for a real treat. And one of the things that they're doing that's really cool is they're taking some of the most common issues that come up in support, and they're actually holding a webinar to host these issues. So while my webinar, while Toby's Tech Talk, is a little bit more on the news side of things, and then I'll show you a specific tip, theirs is more of a conglomeration of different tips and tricks and things that have come up in tech support, common things that have come up in tech support throughout the month. So that's a really awesome webinar. Let me bring up the Prism Engineering webpage so we can see how we can register for that. So it's going to be www.prismeng.com. And then once we take a look there, we go to events. And here's the events page. And you can see here that the next one is going to be Tuesday, February 9th, straight from support. You just click right here and click register, and then you're in. And then we're also having an upcoming seminar, Productive Manufacturing Day here in Horsham. So that's going to be on February 12th as well. So another event you could register for there. But, you know, just keep your eye on our web, our event registration page. We've got lots of good stuff there. All of it's free. So always a good way to spend the day, get a little education. And for those on-site things, there's usually lunch too. So free lunch, you can always come in and just have some free lunch and visit us there in the Horsham office. Okay, so Glenn said he's got them on speed dial. Awesome. That's awesome, Glenn. Love it. Okay, I'm on Twitter. I did post a tweet this week. Mark, for you, okay? I did post a tweet this week and indicated that Toby's Tech Talk was coming up this week. I'm also going to post another one, a second one. So two tweets in 1 week. It's probably going to be a record for me, indicating that I have posted that video on clearing the registry. So check that out. Check out my Toby's Twitter page. A lot of excitement going on that page. The upcoming users group. I have to apologize to Mark Semmel. He did give me the date for the upcoming one at the Lehigh Valley. He emailed it to me. Let's see if we can just find these on the SOLIDWORKS users group page, because I should have had these on here and I didn't. I've been trying to see if they're on here on this website. Let's take a look. So SOLIDWORKS users group network. So I just did a search there for SOLIDWORKS users group. And here we have the users group network, and we could say maybe find a group. And let's say that we're in Pennsylvania. All right, and we've got the Mid-Atlantic users group network. Let's see if we've got the next date for this one posted here. Looks like it is on February 24th. So the users group in Horsham is on February 24th. And let's see if the one in the Lehigh Valley is posted here. Nope, he emailed it to me. I apologize, Mark. I owe you a beer next time. But those are really good users groups to check out. And again, you can just Google the SOLIDWORKS users group and you can find a users group in your area. And I love these users groups events. I'm always happy to speak at them. If you're running a users group or if you know somebody who is and you need a speaker, I'd be happy to come out and give a presentation, tips and tricks, SOLIDWORKS type stuff. So just let me know. Like I said, this one was from last month. I posted this last month. I did have one error on it that Joe pointed out to me. I call this thread out at 113. It's actually 1.8, but I also have the helix data on that print. So if you look at that video on our YouTube page, you can get all that info. And then if you submit that, you'll still be in the running for a perfect score. So I'm giving you an extra month here to come through with a perfect score. Maybe I'll have two models next month or something to even that out. So finally, what more can you do with SOLIDWORKS? What more can you do with the SOLIDWORKS that you've got out of the box? Well, one of the things you can do with SOLIDWORKS, with the SOLIDWORKS that you've got out of the box, is you can take advantage of these four free products that are in SOLIDWORKS 2016. And the reason I wanted to show this for this tech talk this month is because I was teaching a class this month and somebody said, oh, well, we don't have any simulation. We don't have a simulation product. So we can't do any of that stuff with our product. And the fact of the matter is that everybody has a simulation product. Every single seat of SOLIDWORKS ships with SOLIDWORKS Simulation Xpress. Now, when you launch that simulation product, what you might see is a dialog box that comes up that says you need a special code. Let's see here. So it might look something like, whoops, it might look something like this. Where it says, you need a special code. It says, DriveWorks Xpress is an introductory version of the fully featured DriveWorks. To enable DriveWorks Xpress, access DriveWorks Xpress tutorials and learn more about DriveWorks, visit my.solidworks.com/Xpress. And then what will happen is that it will, when you click on that link, when you just take your mouse and you click right here, it takes you to this page that I've got on the right side of my screen. And then you can take this code and you can copy this code in. Now, this code that's listed here is linked to your serial number. So, you know. If you wanted to copy this code down, it's not going to help you. Plus, it's free anyway. So it's like, you know, you're stealing grass out of somebody's front yard or something. Yeah, so don't feel like you have to scramble to take that code down. But you can go to this pull-down menu that I'll show you in a minute. You can choose DriveWorks Xpress, and then you can click on this little link here, and that'll take you to mysolidworks.com where you can enter that code. And you'll have access to DriveWorks Xpress or DFM Xpress or Sim Xpress or Flow Xpress. So let's take a look at these Xpress products here in the SOLIDWORKS software. So like I said, you know, a customer might say, hey, I've got this this idea for a design, but we don't have Simulation Xpress, so you know, we can't really do anything with it. Or we don't have simulation, so we can't really do anything with it. Well, what I could do here is I could come up with a line. Let's say I make that line 4 inches, and I can come across here with another line here, and I could say I'm going to make that 6 inches, and then maybe I'll come down here, say 1 inch, and then I'll come down at an angle, and then I'll close this thing off with another 1 inch line. I'll hit escape, and I'll take that last line and just drag it onto my origin. Gives me a nice fully defined sketch there, and I'm going to do a features extrude, so S key extrude. Here I'm going to type in what I want the thickness to be, so I want it to be a half inch, and then I'm going to right mouse button in the background, and I'm going to say that I want this to be mid-plane, and then I'm going to right mouse button again, and now I'm going to take this face here, begin a sketch, I'm going to do S key offset entities, I'm going to reverse the direction of it and say that I want that to offset in by, say, 3/8 of an inch, S key extrude cut, and I'm going to right mouse button, I'm going to say through all. And then I'm going to right mouse button again. And then I'm going to S key again here. And I'm going to say fillet. And I'm going to pick this edge here. And then I'm going to choose this icon here, which is connected to start loop. And once I choose that, you can see that it's going to give me a fillet for everything that's on the inside of that model. So let's say I make those a half an inch for that fillet there. Yeah, maybe that's a little bit big, a quarter inch. Okay. And then I could do the same thing here. I could do S key fillet and maybe pick this edge here. And then after I pick that edge, I could choose this icon and get all the edges. But the truth is, I really only want this guy and this guy to be filleted. So I'll just make those two guys filleted in 1 inch. Okay, good. So that looks pretty good. So now I've got this bracket here. And now my question is, you know, is this bracket going to hold the desired amount of weight? Maybe I need to just do one last thing here, which is maybe create some mounting holes here. So create a mounting, create a center line here. I know I could have just made these vertical, but, and then I'll create a mounting hole here at 0.25, and I'll create a mounting hole here, and I'll just say that I want those to be equal, and then I'll say that I want those to be dimensioned. Sometimes I'll just right mouse button here and say fully defined sketch, just to like get myself close to the values that I want, and then I'll double click here and change them to the, you know. Always got to fully define our sketches. 0.7. Okay. Now I'll do S key extrude cut. And then for this one, what I'll do is I will double click on this face. And when I do that, it automatically changes my end condition to up to surface. So I did a double click on that face. Get these away from these fields here. So now I can use the command tools simulation express. Now I need to assign a material. So let's say I'll make this out of 1060 aluminum. And then I'm also going to create what's called a split line. So I'm going to pick this face here, begin a sketch, and I'm going to create some geometry that represents where the actual loading is going to come in contact with the shelf. So I'm going to create some split lines here. And normally I would fully define this, but let's say I'm still kind of in preliminary phase. So I'm not going to fully define it. I'm just going to go features, curves. Actually, you know what? I am going to fully define it just because I'm like very... very sensitive about not fully defining my sketches. So I'll say calculate again, use that same trick again there. I just want to kind of get something in there so that it's predictable. So 4.5, say this is going to be 4. And make this 1.5. Now I'm going to do curves, split line, and I'm going to pick this face here. And what happens is SOLIDWORKS takes that face and splits it. 1, 2, 3, 4, 5 faces now across there. Okay, so now I can assign a loading condition here and here, representing where the shelf is actually going to be weighted down. I'll save this model. I'll call it my Sim Express model. And then I'll use the command tools, Express Product Simulation Express. Now, I went through the creation of that model pretty quick. I mean, I talked through it because I wanted to have you guys kind of see what my steps were that I was using there. So I talked through it, but I went through it pretty quick because I just wanted to make sure that you guys kind of know how I'm thinking through the model and how I'm creating the model. But I'm going to spend more time now and slow down a little bit now as we go through the Xpress product. Michael's saying, please synchronize your screen. Yeah, I think it's because I went through it so fast. It was probably my talking was going a lot faster than you guys were actually seeing the model. So I go here to help, I'm sorry, I go here to tools, Xpress products, simulation Xpress. And when I launch it, like I said, the first time I launch it, I'm going to get this dialog box. It says, you don't have simulation Xpress yet, or to access it, you need a code. Then I'm going to go to mysolidworks.com, grab the code and put it into that box. But then after I do it the first time, that's it. I don't have to do it again. So simulation versus simulation Xpress, what are the differences? Well, simulation is going to be a very limited version of Simulation Xpress. Simulation Xpress is going to be a very limited version of simulation. For example, when it comes to fixturing, you're going to see that I'm only able to apply a fixture by selecting a face. When it comes to forces, I'm limited in the way that I can apply the forces. But that doesn't mean that we can't use the product at all. We can absolutely still use a product, as you're going to see in a moment. So here's the Simulation Xpress tutorial over here on the right. Simulation Xpress helps you predict how a part is going to perform. I'm going to choose, you know, my options here if I wanted to control what units I'm working in. So let's say we're working with English, IPS. I can control where the results are going to be stored. And I can choose to show the min-max annotation. This, I think, is important. This will help you understand what's going on with your model. So I would encourage you to turn that on. And then next, you can see here that I'm going to choose next. And it's going to say, where do you want this model to be fixed? So I'm going to say add a fixture. Now, in full-blown simulation, I could choose a vertex, or I could choose an edge. I could choose some additional capabilities, like I could maybe tell the software that I want it to be fixed in two directions, but not the third, or I want it to be a roller slider. You get a lot of options for fixturing when you're in full-blown simulation, but we don't get all those options when we're working in regular SOLIDWORKS Simulation Xpress. So for here, I would say I'm just going to fixture this face and this face. The face is where this is mounting to the wall. And I hit the green check mark. And then it says, do you want to add any additional fixtures? That's because here you can rename these. So this could say mounted to wall. And then maybe I could have one that's mounted to ceiling, or, you know, mounted against the wall over here so it can't come off the wall in this direction. But in this case, I've only got that one single fixture, so I'm ready to move on to the next step. Now, the next step is going to be I can either add a force or I can add a pressure. That's it. That's the only option that I have, either adding a force here or adding a pressure. So, you know, I can't, for example, I can't choose a remote load, or I can't do a prescribed displacement. I can only either add a force or I can add a pressure. So I'm going to say I'm going to add a force here, and that force is going to be on this front edge here. And let's say impound force, that's going to be 200 on that front section there. We load, you know, the majority of it on that front section. I want to make sure that there's only one face selected here. So I want to just make sure that I've only got that one single face selected. So 200 pounds force, and then I'm going to add another force. So this could, maybe I would rename this front load, and then I could add another force, and I'll make this just a little bit less. I'll make this more than 150, and that's going to be on this pad here, this region here. So you can see why doing the split line is helpful in Simulation Xpress, because it lets you kind of localize that load where normally you would only be able to do a point load. So that's only going to be on that rear face, 150. You notice that if I pick more than one face over here on the left, I can say that's the total distributed load, or that's the load per item. So I'm going to say that I want it to be 150, and I'm going to hit the green check mark. And then I'm going to choose next. And then I'm going to choose my material. Now, your material definition in SOLIDWORKS carries right into simulation. So that means that whatever material you assign over here, if I say edit material, is going to be the same material that by default is used in simulation or Simulation Xpress. It also means that you can create your own custom materials. So down here at the bottom, we can create our own custom materials, and we can go through and we can assign our own values. So if you go to a website like www.matweb.com, you can find out information about materials. This is an online materials database. So if I did 1060 aluminum, I could then maybe get the material attributes for 1060 aluminum. Here you go, 1060 aluminum, some different hardening elements to it, and I can actually extract this information and put it into simulation to get more accurate results. So now that I've got my material assigned, I'm going to choose next. The final thing here is that you can do what's called change settings. Now, you can change your mesh density here, and you'll actually be able to see your mesh parameters. And what you want is you want there to be a total of about four elements through thickness. Really, it's two elements as a minimum, but if you can get three or four in there, you're going to be in good shape. So I can see that the length of this edge, I pick on this edge here, and the length says that it's 0.5. So I might want to come over here and make this value like 0.125. For my max element size. That way I can ensure that I'm going to get four elements through thickness. Now, again, that's something that is kind of a feel thing, kind of an experience thing, but just as a general rule, that's kind of a good thing you can do. You can take your minimum wall thickness, divide it by four, and make that your max element size. So now we've got everything that we need to run the study. We click run simulation. And there we go. There we can see our results. And SOLIDWORKS asks us, does this look about the way you would expect it? Is this deforming as expected? And if you say yes, you can continue and look at your results. If you say no, you can return to your load fixtures. So I could say yes, let's go on and look at the results. And here it says, based on the factor of safety of 1, here's all the areas where the factor of safety is going to be below 1. So here's all the areas where I'm going to have problems with this design. And I can say show displacement, and we can see here what the resultant displacement is. Now this is at a deformation scale of 16 to 1. So, you know, this is something where, our displacement, you have to look at it up here. It's 0.03 millimeters. I'm sorry, 0.03 inches. So it looks like it looks to be a lot greater than it is because of the displacement scale. And you can also say, show me the von Mises stress. So show me the areas where it's stressing out the most. So this area here where it's stressing out right around that bolt hole, that's an area where I would consider that what's called a stress singularity. So I wouldn't really worry too much about that just because of how it's fixtured. But there may be some other areas where it's, far beyond the material yield strength, which you can see here. It actually shows you the yield strength in the tree here. Or again, if we look at our factor of safety. So then the last thing that we can do when we're done viewing the results is we can actually create an optimization study. You can see here we say, do you want to optimize your model? And I can say yes. And I can actually tell the software to continue to vary a parameter, like vary the thickness here until I get to the optimum results. So really cool stuff here from Simulation Xpress. And certainly, even though it's a free product, you can get a lot of value out of this product. I don't know that I necessarily would take these results and say, yes, it's gonna break or it's not going to break based on these results. But certainly one extremely valuable application of this is that you could do what if or if then scenarios or comparison scenarios. So I could, for example, say, okay, what if I made this dimension a little bit wider? So I go to my boss extrude here and I say, what if I make this 1 inch? And what if I make this offset dimension a little bit greater as well? So what if I made that 1/2 inch? And then once I make those changes, I can return to my Simulation Xpress study and I can run it again. And now when I run my Simulation Xpress study again, I can look at my results once again. And when looking at these results, I can again say, show me the areas where the factor of safety is below 1. And look at that. It's gotten much better. So for if-then scenarios, Simulation Xpress absolutely gets a thumbs up from Toby. And it's a terrific solution, and it's free. So a question came in here. When applying total force over multiple faces, how does SOLIDWORKS divide the load? It's based on surface area. Yeah, I've tested that before. At least when I tested it, it was based on surface area, which was probably about 4 years ago. So yeah, it's great question. It's based on surface area. So the question was, if you do a distributed load about these faces, how does it actually distribute that load? It's based on surface area. Now, in full-blown simulation, you can do what's called a remote load, where you can control where the load is coming from. So then you'll get a vector, and that's going to factor into how force is distributed as well. But in Simulation Xpress, it's just straight up based on surface area per face. So if this face was larger, it would have greater force applied to it because it's got larger surface area. So some other products that we've got in there our Xpress suite are products like Flow Simulation Xpress. So I could, for example, choose my top plane here, begin a sketch, orient my view, create a box, say that I want that box to be 6 by 3, extrude that box, say I want it to be 1 inch tall, shell that box, features shell, don't select any faces, 0.1 for the shell. What I just did there was I made the box hollow. And then I could choose this end here, and I could say that I want there to be an inlet at that end. I'm going to extrude that up to next. And I could do the same thing on the other end. So I'm going to hold control here and drag that cut extrude and drop it on this face, and that way it goes up to next on that face too. So copy a feature by doing a control drag. Now I'm going to save this model. Flow Sim Xpress. And then I'm going to go to my Xpress products, and I'm going to say Flow Xpress. And I'm going to do a Flow Xpress study on this model. So here it says, welcome to Flow Xpress. With Flow Xpress, you can do a single internal cavity with one inlet and one outlet. The openings must be closed with lids. Please make sure the openings are completely closed with lids. Okay, so I don't currently have lids on this thing, so I'm going to just make them real quick. So I'll do just do a quick extrusion here. I'll take this guy and I'll do a convert entities, and I'll do an extrusion. And I'll say it's midplane at 0.1. And then in the definition of that, well, you know what, that's okay. I'll just leave it like that. And I'll do the same thing on this end. Select this face, pick this guy, convert, and I'll do an extrusion, midplane at 0.1. And now we'll do our flow express. So we'll go tools, express products, flow express. And we can say here that we've got our fluid volume. So there it is. It's an enclosed area. Excellent. We go next. We say, what's the type of fluid that's passing through here? It's going to be air. And then it says here, select our initial inlet. So I'll say that's going to be a volume flow rate on this face. I'll use select other here to get that inlet face of, let's say, 10 cubic inches per second. And then for our outlet is going to be over here. So I'll right mouse button, select other, pick this face here. I'll go next. And I will choose solve. And our flow simulation is going to go through and it's going to attempt to solve this this flow simulation study. Okay, simple inlet, simple outlet, but certainly the geometry doesn't have to be this simple. I'm just showing you guys how you can get it started and the fact that you can run with this type of software right out of the box, right out of the box SOLIDWORKS. It's just straight up included in the software. You know, while this one is running, another free product that's included in SOLIDWORKS, SOLIDWORKS Express products is DFM Express. And what DFM Express is it's designed for manufacturability, DFM Express. And this comes free with SOLIDWORKS also. So here you can see it says DFM Express functionality includes drilled holes, hole diameter to depth ratio. What does that mean? That means that when you create a hole in the machining world, if the diameter is too small relative to the depth of the hole, then the bit will break off as you're trying to drill that hole. Well, DFM Express, designed for manufacturability, will go through and it will check for those types of things. You can establish a listing of checks in the beginning. And that way, if you get people on your team who maybe aren't as familiar with the manufacturing process, they can go through and they can run these checks. And I'll show you that in a moment here once this flow simulation study is done running. So now what I could do is I could maybe change this to be the ability to see the inside here. And we could maybe plot out these trajectories so we can actually see this thing running through. Let's see here. We're looking at a velocity plot here. And we're going from the inlet, just letting it calculate at the moment. Let's see, I'm just going to hide this solid body. This pipes at the inlet. I guess we do it at the outlet. There we go. Had to change the wireframe. So now you can actually see what the results are of that flow simulation, and you can even get trajectory plots. So I'll just change this back to the inlet plot here and run it again. And there you can see that flow simulation will actually give you a plot of that trajectory. And again, this is a totally free product. So some really cool stuff that you guys have got there. You've got DFM Express as well. Like I said, with tools, Express products, DFM Express. What you can do over here, this is designed for manufacturability. You can click settings here. And you can see that for mill drill, you could set a hole depth diameter ratio, percentage of hole inside of part, make sure there's enough meat inside the part to drill a hole. Mill tool depth diameter, make sure that there's a minimum, maybe minimum radius for certain types of parts. You've got the ability to check for turned parts with mill drill. You've got the ability to check sheet metal parts and injection molding parts. So this would be a product that would be really handy if you had people on your team who weren't as familiar with the manufacturing process. They could actually run one of these checks before they submit the part for approval. And then finally, the last product that's in there is Tools, DriveWorks Express. And DriveWorks Express is an awesome product. Now, I did a series of videos of these. They're on our YouTube page, so I'm not going to go into too much detail on it here. But DriveWorks Express is an awesome product where you can create basically a form. You can say, I want a box like this that's this wide by this high, has this many holes in it, it's made out of this material. And then you click Go, and SOLIDWORKS goes through and makes that entire project for you, whether it's a part or an assembly, all of the options that you've configured on that form. It's a configurator tool. DriveWorks will go through and it'll actually generate that permutation of your design. You can check out the DriveWorks website. It's driveworks.co.uk. And it's an awesome website. And they have examples on there in DriveWorks Express that you can actually download and run on your own computer. So you can download a full DriveWorks Express project and run it on your computer to kind of see what the capabilities really are with DriveWorks Express. That does bring us up to the 1 o'clock hour. I want to, of course, offer you any questions you have. Feel free to ask them over on the right, or you can email me, swtech@prismeng.com. I want to wish you guys a wonderful remainder of your Wednesday. I hope you guys have a great weekend. I'll post this video on YouTube, and the episode 50 has already been posted. But again, I just want to thank you all so much for tuning in. Check out our training classes. Check out our other webinars. Come visit us at Prism Engineering in Horsham, Pennsylvania, or at any one of our other offices. And again, just thank you all so much for tuning in. Thanks for the support. And be sure to tune in next week. We got our Straight from Support webinar with Heather and Aaron on Tuesday next week. All right, we'll see you guys next time. Thanks a lot, Joe. Thanks, Teresa. Thank you, Tim. Great seeing you. Thanks, Joe. Thank you, John. Thanks for tuning in. Chad, I'll see you. Robin, thanks for tuning in. Randall, always good to see you in here. Devery, nice. Good to see you in here, my friend. Ken, thank you as always. James, how are you doing? Thanks for tuning in. Tony, see you next time, sir. Steve, thank you very much. Seth, Michael, Kate, thank you very much. And Perry, awesome. Thanks. Great seeing you in here again. Matthew, thanks so much for tuning in. And Scott, thank you very much. Appreciate the support. Glad you can make it today. And if anybody has any questions, feel free to put them in over on the right. Otherwise, send me an email, swtech@prismeng.com. Always happy to answer any questions you guys have. All right, I think that's going to do it. I'm not getting any questions, so I'm going to end the session, let you guys get back to work. Thank you again for tuning in, and I'll see you guys next time. Bye-bye.